Hello guys, this is Leo the Wise, giving to all men, their needed uprise.
Needless to say, this is a violation of the US Constitution on many levels, and is incompatible with the values of any supposedly advanced democracy that prides itself on freedom and liberty. There is effectively a tyrannical leftist shadow state operating within US borders but entirely outside the US Constitution, which can subject a man to horrors more worthy of North Korea than the US, even if he did not want out of the marriage, did not want to be separated from his children, and did not want to lose his job. Any unsuspecting man can be sucked into this shadow state. Anyone who believes that two-parent families are important to the continuance of an advanced civilization should focus on the explosive growth in revenue earned by divorce lawyers, court supervisors, and feminist organizations over the past quarter century. If Western society is to survive, these revenues should be chopped down to a tenth of what they presently are, which is what they would be if the elements that violate the US Constitution were repealed. Marriage is no longer a gateway to female companionship, as we shall discuss later. For this reason, as a futurist, I cannot recommend marriage, as the grotesque parody that it has become today, to any young man living in the US, UK, Canada, or Australia. There are just too many things outside of his control that can catastrophically ruin his finances, emotions, and quality of life. At a minimum, he should make sure that having children is the most important goal of his life. If not, then he has insufficient reason to enter this contract. If this goal is affirmed, then he should conduct research by speaking to a few divorced men about the laws and mistreatment they were subjected to, and attend a few divorce court hearings at the local courthouse. After gaining this information, if he still wants to take the risk, he should only marry if he can meet the following three conditions, none of which can substitute either of the other two. 1. The woman earns the same as, or more than, he does. 2. He has a properly done prenuptial arrangement with lawyers on each side. Even though a prenup will not affect the worst aspect of divorce law, child support is a cloak for stealth alimony and possible imprisonment. 3. He is deeply competent in the Venusian arts, and can manage his relationship with his wife effortlessly. More on this later. There are still substantial risks, but at least they are somewhat reduced under these conditions. If marriage is a very important goal for a young man, he should seriously consider expatriation to a developing country, where he ironically may have a higher living standard than in the US after adjusting for divorce risk. So, to review, the differences between marriage 1.0 and marriage 2.0 are: a. No fault asset division and alimony, where the abandoned spouse has to pay if he earns more, even if he did not want a divorce, and even if he is a victim of abuse, cuckolding, or adultery. There are rare instances of high-earning women getting caught in this trap as well. B. Women marrying after having five or more sexual partners, compared to just 0-1 previously. This makes it harder for the woman to form a pair bond with her husband. C. Women marrying at an age when very few years of their peak beauty are remaining, compared to a decade or more remaining under marriage 1.0. D. Child custody is almost never granted to the man, so he loses his children on a no-fault basis. Traditional cultures marketed marriage with such punctilious alacrity that most people today dare not even question whether the traditional truths still apply. Hence, hostility often ensues from a mere attempt to even broach the topic of whether marriage is still the same concept as it once was. Everyone from women to sadistic social conservatives to a young man's own parents will pressure and shame him into marriage for reasons they cannot even articulate, and condemn his request for a prenup, without having any interest in even learning about the horrendously unequal and carefully concealed laws he would be subjected to in the event that his wife divorces him through no reasons he can discern. But some men with an eye on self-preservation are figuring this out, and are avoiding marriage. By many accounts, 22% of men have decided to avoid marriage. So what happens to a society that makes it unattractive for even just 20% of men to marry? Women are far more interested in marriage than men. Simple logic of supply and demand tells us that the institution of monogamous marriage requires at least 80% male participation in order to be viable. When male participation drops below 80%, all women are in serious trouble, since there are now 100 women competing for every 80 men, compounded with the reality that women age out of fertility much quicker than men. This creates great stress among the single female population. In the past, the steady hand of a young woman's mother and grandmother knew that her beauty was temporary, and that the most seductive man was not the best husband, and they made sure that the girl was married off to a boy with long-term durability. Now that this guidance has been removed from the lives of young women, thanks to feminism, these women are proving to be poor pilots of their mating lives who pursue alpha males until the age of 34-36, when her desirability drops precipitously and not even beta males she used to reject are interested in her. This stunning plunge in her prospects with men is known as the Wile E. Coyote moment, and women of yesteryear had many safety nets that protected them from this fate. The feminist media's attempt to normalize cougarhood is evidence of gasping desperation to package failure as a desirable outcome, which will never become mainstream due to sheer biological realities. Women often protest that a high number of sexual partners should not be counted as a negative on them, as the same is not a negative for men. But this is merely a manifestation of solipsism. A complex sexual past works against women even if the same works in favor of men, due to the natural sexual attraction triggers of each gender. A wise man once said, "A key that can open many locks is a valuable key, but a lock that can be opened by many keys is a useless lock." The big irony is that feminism, rather than improving the lives of women, has stripped away the safety nets of mother-grandmother guidance that would have shielded her from ever having to face her Wile E. Coyote moment. Feminism has thus put the average woman at risk in yet another area. The Venusian arts game The Four Sirens and the legal changes feminists have instituted to obstruct beta men have created a climate where men have invented techniques and strategies to adapt to the more challenging marketplace, only to exceed their aspirations. This is a disruptive technology in its own right. All of us know a man who is neither handsome nor wealthy, but consistently has amazing success with women. He seems to have natural instincts regarding women that to the layperson may be indistinguishable from magic. So how does he do it? Mars is the god of war, while Venus is the goddess of love. Study of combat is thus known as the martial arts, while the study of attraction, seduction, and romance is known as the Venusian arts, as coined by Misandry, a pioneer in the field. Detractors with a vested interest in the present status quo are eager to misrepresent what the Venusian arts are, but as a definition, the traits that make a man attractive to women are learnable skills that improve with practice. Once a man learns these skills, he is indistinguishable from a man who had natural talents in this area. Whether a man then chooses to use these skills to secure one solid relationship or multiple brief ones is entirely up to him. The subject is too vast for any description over here to do it full justice, but in a nutshell, the internet age enabled communities of men to share the various bits of knowledge they had field tested and refined. For example, one man being an expert at meeting women during the daytime, another being an expert at step-by-step sexual escalation, yet another being a master of creating lasting love, etc. The collective knowledge grew and evolved, and an entire industry to teach the various schools of game emerged. Men who comprehended the concepts of minority and those who could undertake the total reconstitution of their personalities and avalanche of rejections as part of the learning curve, a still smaller minority stood to reap tremendous benefits from becoming more attractive than the vast majority of unaware men. While the pickup artist PUA implementation is the most media covered, the principles are equally valuable for men in monogamous long-term relationships LTRs. See Charlotte Allen's cover story for the Weekly Standard, devoted to game. Among the most valuable learnings from the body of knowledge is the contrarian revelation that what women say a man should do is often quite the antithesis of what would actually bring him success. For example, being a needy, supplicative, eager to please man is precisely the opposite behavior that a man should employ, where being dominant, teasing, amused, yet assertive is the optimal persona. An equally valuable lesson is to realize when not to take a woman's words at face value. Many statements from her are tests to see if the man can remain congruent in his alpha personality, where the woman is actually hoping the man does not eagerly comply to her wishes. Similarly, the feminist Pavlovian reaction to call any non-compliant man a misogynist should also not be taken as though a rational adult assigned the label after fair consideration. Such shaming language is only meant to deflect scrutiny and accountability from the woman uttering it, and should be given no more importance than a 10-year-old throwing a tantrum to avoid responsibility or accountability. Far too many men actually take these slurs seriously, to the detriment of male rights and dignity. Success in internalizing the core fundamentals of the Venusian arts requires an outside-the-box thinker solidly in the very top of Maslow's hierarchy, and in my experience, 80% of men and 99.9% of women are simply incapable of comprehending why the skills of the Venusian arts are valuable and effective. Many women, and even a few pathetic men, condemn the Venusian arts, without even gaining a minimal comprehension for what it truly is, which I have highlighted in red above, and how it benefits both men and women. Most of what they think they know about the Venusian arts involves strawmen, a lack of basic research, and their own sheer insecurity. For anyone seeking advice on the Venusian arts, there is one rule you must never break. I believe it is of paramount importance that the knowledge be used ethically, and with the objective of creating mutually satisfying relationships with women. It is not moral to mistreat women, even if they have done the same to countless men. We, as men, have to take the high road even if women are not, and this is my firm belief. Nice guys can finish first if they have game.
And that is it for now. If this content was entertaining and interested you, please share, like, and subscribe to this channel. I am the Swan, leading men till dawn, and even beyond. Thanks for the audience.